Lars Christensen, thank you, first of all. The Danske Bank Global Scenarios report in April noted that the main risk to the global economic recovery was an escalation of the euro crisis.
Yeah.
Are we seeing that right now in terms of what's happening in Spain? Ireland has actually dipped back into recession. The Dutch government has fallen. There's uncertainty in France. Are we heading towards another euro crisis?
I'd say in the way that October, November last year, we were very close to the abyss. I think very few people really realized how bad things were developing in the European economies, and the escalation of financial distress was very serious. Luckily, we pulled out of that. I believe that the introduction of the so-called LTO, three-year LTO, provided monetary stimulus that took us away from the abyss. But we're still very, very close to the edge. And I think that what have happened over the last one and a half months has especially concerned, really, monetary policy accommodation. Will the ECB start to withdraw some of the accommodative measures? Once things are fine, we get a feeling of that maybe we should withdraw some of this. And once we hear that, the markets dip back into uncertainty. And the macroeconomic ramifications of that is relatively fast. I think what we're seeing now in the Irish economy is probably more the lagged effect of what happened in the autumn rather than something new. So what we're seeing on the economic side is probably that. But what we're seeing on the political side across Europe is of course also a fact that we don't have any growth. And we have had now 4 years of austerity measures being implemented in many places. And it's natural that people want to see results. And they're getting, you know, you're getting political backlash. But those are, I think, issues that somebody should be kept away from in terms of analyzing or thinking about the situation. Where are we heading going forward?
But I mean, Ireland's recovery, as we've seen in the figures, is weakening in that we have slipped back into recession. Unemployment is unmoved in 2 years. It's hovering around the 14% mark. I mean, is this not an argument that austerity isn't working in the case of Ireland? It is not the poster boy for austerity, and that there needs to be a change of tact by the government here.
I think that the discussion we have now in Europe about austerity is a completely fair discussion that we need to have. I think, however, it's slightly misguided in the focus. I do not think that austerity has failed in Ireland. I think the things we've done in Ireland has overall been the right things to do. But we have to see the fiscal side of it and the monetary side of it. And I don't think the problem is really with fiscal austerity. I think the problem is with the lack of monetary easing. So you can say that the responsibility of governments is to keep the house in order. And it's also given by the fact you can't spend more money than you have. And this, the point was there have been huge deficit in public finances in Ireland, and that needed to be reduced. However, the ECB also need to deliver in terms of providing some stability on the outlook for GDP and for growth. And therefore, I think what we really should debate, rather than debating whether austerity is right or wrong, we should debating we need to have more monetary easing. So we should continue down the road of austerity if that means balancing the budget over the long run. But that would be tremendously much easier if we had growth in the economies. We cannot do that by stimulating.
But the argument is that austerity restricts growth because.
Yeah.
Do you not accept that then, that the austerity measures that have been implemented in Ireland have restricted growth? The economy cannot grow because too many people are unemployed.
I do accept that it has an impact, clearly, but I'm skeptical about that is at the core of it. The core of this is that basically the ECB is keeping monetary policy too tight, and I think the ECB has to some extent chosen a rather dangerous strategy in terms of saying, oh, we will not deliver too much monetary stimulus because then we're letting the governments off the hook. But you know, you cannot run around punishing the Greek government, punishing the Spanish government, without at the same time punishing the Irish government, who have done the austerity that's needed. You cannot, with that very blunt instrument monetary policy is, you cannot go around differentiate this. And I think, frankly speaking, that the ECB has been been too eager to use monetary policy as a political threat to push through reforms. I think the reforms are necessary, and I do not question the need for example, labor market reform in Spain, or doing something about the Spanish pension system or the French pension systems, or pushing through budget cuts in Ireland. These things are necessary to look at, but it's not at the core of the crisis. The core of the crisis is that monetary policy in 2011 became excessively tight in Europe. And the LTRO showed that when we move away from that, we start to move out of the crisis.
So talk about then some of the, briefly if you can, some of the measures that the ECB, the practical measures that the ECB could implement.
I think first of all, the ECB needs to work on its communication policy. We need to have a situation where we don't communicate from week to week, from month to month, and speak with 10, 20, 30 different voices. The best way to do that was to have a clear connection between the monetary policy instruments that are, and measures put in place and what we want to achieve. So let's say that the ECB said we want to increase nominal GDP by 15 or 10% or 5% over the next year or the next 2 years. And they could connect that with the instruments being in place saying, okay, if we hit that target, until we hit that target, these instruments will be in place. The LTRO will be in place as long as the European economy is performing subpar growth. You know, so and we need to be much more rule-based. The ECB always claims to be rule-based, but we actually need to have a much more transparent policy, because then we will not get into the situation we got into in October, November, where the markets basically loses track on where the ECB is in this. Because what happened in October, November was very much that market participants thought, okay, the ECB might not be around. They might actually allow the European economy to go into depression and have serious deflationary pressures. And once that happens, then the negative spiral in the markets and economy gets out of control. And I think that's where the Federal Reserve have moved in that direction, and that actually stabilizes quite a bit now.
So something like quantitative easing?
Oh, yeah, I think fundamentally Europe needs much more quantitative easing, but I also think it should be done within a very, very clear rule framework. And it should not be about bailing out countries or bailing out banks, but ensuring that the European economy do not go into deflationary downward spiral.
What about, I think you talked a little bit in your presentation today about the comparisons with 1931 and the debt relief that was given to Germany. And
yeah.
You talked about Greece.
Yeah.
What about Ireland?
I think that these issues are exactly connected to the same thing about growth. That if the question is, would Ireland need more debt relief, or would we need debt relief in Ireland? Well, if the ECB tomorrow decide to increase interest rates by 100 basis points and say we are not giving any more stimulus, then it's very certain that Ireland would need some kind of debt restructuring and money. But if the ECB conduct monetary policy in a proper fashion, then I can't see that there would be that need for Ireland. So that's very much the same we saw in the 1930s. What we saw in the 1930s was countries that gave up the gold standard, countries like Sweden, countries like the UK, performed quite strongly through the Great Depression, while a country like Austria, who maintained a gold standard until 1938, when the country defaulted and ceased to exist as an independent nation, there is a very big difference between the two. And luckily, we don't have a gold standard today, but sometimes the euro works as a gold standard. But the good thing is that we can print euros. We couldn't print gold, so we can avoid that deflationary spiral if we choose to. But sometimes you get the feeling that the ECB is not entirely committed to that.
Looking back, I guess, I mean, you wrote on your blog last December that a less fanciful explanation for most crises is that the simple one, that some nations are simply more lucky or unlucky than others. I think you were referring particularly to Iceland, but to what extent does this apply to what's happened in Ireland? I mean, has Ireland just been unlucky in the way it's...
I think that I like to quote Milton Friedman on this. Milton Friedman talked about never underestimate the luck of nations. And I think there is a lot to do with that. Let's say Ireland, for some reason, that joined the euro, had a floating exchange rate, and then joined the euro in 2006, then you wouldn't have an emergence of a massive property market bubble, and the Irish economy would probably been one of the would have been a Dutch economy or Finnish economy. I don't think that Ireland I'm very reluctant when people tend to put national stereotypes on this crisis. You would hear the story about, oh, the Greeks are lazy, or oh, the Irish are like that, or the Icelandic government.
What's the national stereotype about Ireland, do you think?
Well, I think you would know that better than me, but you know, but the interesting thing is they all became the same stereotype. You know, the stereotype about the Greeks and the Icelandic and the Spaniards and Ireland becomes the same in the media discussion about this, and I strongly resent that. And you know, countries that are performing good now, like the Nordic countries, take Sweden, take Norway, had very, very, very serious crises in the early 90s. So you know, I resent the idea that certain countries simply cannot perform well. Policy do matter, but a lot of things how monetary policy works is also when you enter different systems. When do you enter into a fixed exchange rate or a floating exchange rate? That a lot is a lot to do with Iceland. With Logan, Iceland was a very clear example of when then they liberalized their banking legislation. Well, they did that at the same time we had very easy monetary policy globally. And that was very unfortunate.
Was Ireland's main mistake the banking guarantee in September 2008?
I think that would be too simple.
Just to interrupt, but yeah. I think you talked at some point about the fact that Iceland is the model.
Yeah.
I don't think it guaranteed banks to the extent that Ireland did.
No, I think, but that I would say that is a discussion about the Irish and the Icelandic situation, that there are clear similarities, but there are certainly also very different things here. And I think we have to remember what it's always, you know, it's often said, you know, in Ireland, we should just have to let the banks die. You know, there are certainly strong arguments for that. But, and people would then say, they did that in Iceland. Well, they didn't do that in Iceland. To get the facts entirely right, what the Icelandic government did was to let the international operations of the Icelandic banks fail. The domestic operations were taken over by the government. So in that sense, that was exactly similar to the Irish situation. But just the sheer size of the bailout in Ireland was much bigger than what we saw in Iceland. But it's actually, it's very simplified to say that the Icelandic government let the entire banking sector fail. They didn't do that. They took over the domestic part of the banking sector. So in that sense, I think the major mistake in terms of what happened in Ireland was the way it played out in terms of the rest of Europe. I think it was extremely unfortunate that there was not much more coordination between different state guarantees given in different places in Europe in those very hectic days and weeks of 2008.
So there should have been a coordinated policy across Europe.
Absolutely. Because we saw some very significant spillover from one country to another, and you know, we had a competition to guarantee the most, and that has some very unfortunate negative ramification for the banking sector across Europe that it clearly escalated the crisis. So I think that is really the greatest mistake. And you can say, okay, you make mistakes when, you know, a fire erupt. But okay, acknowledging those mistakes, we need to look forward, at least ensure that will not happen again.
Housing debt relief and debt relief for mortgage holders. I think Iceland has done some of that.
Yeah.
You said that's a very good idea, and that
any
economist would agree with that. I mean, we haven't had that here yet.
No.
There's a perception that the government is very slow in moving through the legislation to make this happen. How urgent do you think it is? How necessary do you think it is?
I think it's important to do it right, and rather than it's not something that is terribly urgent and it won't change anything, and it's not something if we don't do it now we will never come out.
But I mean, there are mortgage holders that are suffering every day.
Yes, sure. But the meaning is that it's important to do it right, rather than get a panic solution where we do something and just say, okay, we need to do exactly as Iceland. But I do think that if you have households or you have companies that are insolvent, it should be acknowledged. If that means that there will be losses to the banking sector, well, then that's just too bad. I think that's important to acknowledge that. Insolvent companies, insolvent households, they are insolvent. You cannot save them. That being said, certain households and companies are also insolvent because there's no growth. Bank of Ireland came out with a report today or yesterday on the property prices. The property prices are significantly undervalued in Ireland. I would agree on that. And if we had a situation where we had more European growth, the problem with insolvency, both on the corporate side and the household side in Ireland, would drop dramatically. So I think that when you think about what you do on debt restructuring, you also have to think that in terms of what's happening with the economy. So I think the best solution to the debt problems is growth. And we do get that from the ECB becoming much more aggressive. And then at the same time, we of course have to handle the remaining debt problems. Will we have debt write-downs? Will we have further consolidation of public finances, et cetera, et cetera? But this is a package, and it needs to be addressed like that.
Could banks do more to perhaps reduce mortgage interest rates for homeowners? We've seen Permanent TSB has today reduced its rate by 0.5%. National Irish Bank last November raised its by nearly 1%, I think.
Yeah.
I mean, it strikes a lot of people as if the best thing to do would be to lower rates for mortgage holders.
Yeah, you can say that's a collective debt reduction. You're moving the losses from the household to the, or the cost from the household to the banks, and that's of course a possibility. That, however, would be rather blunt also as an instrument compared to more focused debt restructuring. I'm certainly not a big expert on the Irish banking sector to be able to say what that would have impact on in terms of the health of the banking sector. But I would say that.
But would it help homeowners?
Obviously, if homeowners didn't have to pay interest rates,
example. It's not about paying interest rates, but it's about reducing them.
Yes.
Slightly.
No, but that might be part of a solution. I'm not sure about that. I probably would lean much more in the direction of more focused debt restructuring, because then you're sure you will actually go to those households and companies that are insolvent and make a decision on that. And that's the important thing to do, that we get that out of the way. We don't want to create a situation with a zombie banking system. And if we do not address insolvency issues, we'll do that. In my view, the banks are working on that. But obviously, that is an important thing that it should never be allowed. That we get insolvent companies and households remaining insolvent forever. It's not in the interest of the banks. It's not in the interest of the households or the corporations.
Just finally, Lars, the fiscal compact referendum. There is obviously a lot of talk about that in Ireland at the minute. What is your view on it, first of all, and second, I guess what are the ramifications of a no vote?
Well, I'd say first of all, as a foreign bank, I'm probably not the one to come and tell the Irish public what to vote on this. We have a great tradition, both in Ireland and Denmark, of voting on EU issues and other things. And sometimes we vote no, and sometimes we vote yes. And I'll leave that to the Irish public to decide on. But I think the most important thing, at least from the economist's perspective, is we don't want to scare anybody in any direction here.
The Irish finance minister has come out today and said that if we vote no, there will be a harsher budget this year. That's could be perceived as scaring people. That's not right, is it?
Well, that will completely depend on the market reaction to it. And the market reaction, on the other hand, will depend on what's the sentiment of the day. We can be in a situation where the market reaction is violent, and other situation where there's much lesser reaction to it. And I think that what we have to acknowledge from Irish situation is that Ireland might be Ireland as a country, but in economic terms, we're completely dependent on what's happening in the Eurozone or what's happening. And therefore, everything that happens in the markets will depend on the combination of what Ireland do on its own, but also what the ECB do. And that's to me, and when we talk about fiscal policy, I strongly believe that we should not give up austerity measures. We should not give up balancing the budget. whether the outcome of the vote is yes or no, it's important to balance the budget.
So but it's a good thing, the fiscal compact.
I think it's, well, I think, I will just quote my mom, you cannot spend more money than you have. The EU don't have to tell me that. The market don't have to tell me that. That I know, that every Irishman know that. I would say that that fiscal decision would have to be said without the fiscal compact. But I also strongly believe that we need to get more support from the ECB in terms of growth in Europe. The combination of tighter tighter fiscal policy and looser monetary policy will get us out of this crisis. That was the recipe, for example, for Sweden in the 90s. That's the way you consolidate public finances best, by having some monetary support.
Finally, is Ireland going to need a second bailout next year?
Ireland? Never.
No?
Well, again, if we get mistakes on the fiscal side, if we say, okay, we don't want to discuss austerity, then we can create a situation where that happens. Or if the ECB fails, if ECB do what they did in October, November, and add to the uncertainty, then I certainly would not rule that out. But it's not our main scenario. It's not our main scenario, as fiscal consolidation is likely to follow. And we are hopeful that the ECB has learned from the mistakes of last year and will continue to give support to growth in Europe, as we are also relatively optimistic on global growth. And in that scenario, we're not looking at a new package.
So Ireland can return to the markets in 2013?
We certainly hope so.
Okay. Thank you very much.